Hi, have you heard about Bitcoin? Not Bitcoin, but Bipcoin. Bravo, India, Papa, coin. Bipcoin is a new cryptocurrency that you can start mining today for free on ordinary computers. Unlike most altcoins, Bipcoin is not a clone of Bitcoin. Bipcoin is based on entirely new, more recent, and better code called Crypto Note. So unlike Bitcoin, Bipcoin has truly untraceable transactions, does not require specialized mining rigs, and has adaptive limits. Plus, Bipcoin is the only cryptocurrency covered by the BIPCOT no government license. This allows use and reuse by anyone except governments and government agents. If you're still kicking yourself in the head for not getting in on the ground floor of Bitcoin, start mining, using, and trading Bipcoin today.
Not a guarantee.
Mining Bipcoin costs you nothing but the electricity to run your computer. And we already take Bipcoin for stickers and buttons. Go to bipcoin.org. That's bipcoin.org. Once again, that's Bravo India Papa Coin.org.
If you're this angry and hateful towards your neighbors at 40, I mean, I honestly can't imagine what 80s.
I've been
like.
Angry and hateful at my neighbors since I was a little kid.
Are you
kid,
just gonna fire a bazooka at any location at anybody that just makes a sound?
I have not
with?
Shot anybody yet over this. I don't think it's gonna happen now.
Yet,
what he's gonna do? He's gonna get a hold of a recreational McNuke from the local McWarlord.
Oh yeah.
Because by then we'll all be living in Ancapistan, so we'll be able to do that.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
That will be wonderful. Seeds of liberty. 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 Seeds of liberty.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the 100th episode of the Seeds of Liberty podcast.
Yay!
Yeehaw! As always, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by a BIPCOT no government license. This allows reuse by anyone except governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org. So this week, we are brought to you by Discord, and also brought to you by the upcoming Freedom BnB app, which is a Ben Stone project. Ben, the bad Quaker, is someone we've had on the show before, and as we talked about last week, hopefully is going to be joining us next week. But the project is up and running, and the Indiegogo campaign is on, and all that information can be found at hobosymbols.com. So go check that out. I'll make sure to put that in the show notes. So I am Jeremy. I am joined, as always, by Dave.
What's up? What's up?
And we have Andrei here again with us this week. What's up, Andrei?
Just another wonderful day on Seeds of Liberty podcast. Thanks for having me on.
Spectacular. And this week, for our 100th episode, we have a very special guest, someone who our longtime listeners should recognize. He, of course, is our friend and former co-host, Mr. Danilo Cuellar. Hey, Danilo, how are you, my friend?
Hey, guys. Glad to be on. And very excited to be part of the 100th episode.
We just had to have you back on for it, man. As soon as Jeremy said it, I was like, oh, yeah, that's perfect sense. That makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
And as a guy who's been following the podcast for, you know, a little while now, I just want to say it's an honor to be on the podcast with you, Danilo. You do great work and you put out great content. So it's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I'm not exactly up to date, as Jeremy knows. I'm not exactly the quickest to put out the shows, but I have my own pace.
Well, anything has to be better than what I do. I'm one of these guys, like once every so often I'll just sit down and just jam out podcasts for like 10 hours straight, and then I'll just get my fill and just be done with it.
I think he's talking about putting out his own podcast.
Oh.
Danilo takes forever to do that type of stuff.
Right.
Well, I've been liking those videos you put out every so often. They're very inspirational, very kind. You know, like everyone wants to be upset and trying to get everyone fired up and riled up these days, it feels like. And your message of kindness and niceness and stuff like that, it's I like it. I like it, to say the least. That's why I always share all your stuff, man.
Yeah, exactly. Same here.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. I try to focus on being inspiring, uplifting, positive solutions, because I think this these topics can get a little bit gloomy and get people down. And I think it's important that we show people that this philosophy makes us happier, more content human beings. And I think that will make it more attractive to others when we convey it. So that's my goal.
Yeah, you started doing those a couple months ago, right? You started doing like short videos again.
I give all the credit to you guys. You guys are the one.
Well, yeah,
it was Dave, I think.
Yeah, well, we talked to you about it, and you had said that you left this podcast because of time constraints and stuff, and with everything right. with the kids that you were doing, and you were getting so backlogged with Peaceful Anarchism as it was. But then you kept saying, you know, you're trying to find ways to get content out, and you didn't know how. And both of us were just like, you've done these little videos in the past. Why not just do them? Just 10 minutes. It's all it takes. If time constraints is the issue, then find 10 minutes, 10, 15 minutes of your time. Well, yeah. You know, I mean, we're very lucky.
Considering our our niche, you get pretty good views.
Yeah, yeah, and you're right. I'm able to do it once a week. It's basically a basic goal of mine per week is one video a week, and I've been pretty consistent with that. And
you're slowly inspiring me to do it as well.
Definitely. I mean,
thinking of things to talk about. Stuff, and I'm like, I wish for 5 seconds I could talk as beautifully as Danilo.
Well, do you script those out at all, or do you just shoot from the hip on all of them?
No, those are all impromptu. I mean, I have a. Subject that I start talking about, but after that I just go with it. And being outdoors is really inspiring for me. Although lately it's been freezing, and I'm not.
Yeah, I know and that. So
I've
been forced indoors, which is not as inspiring. It's never really scripted. It's just, I try to speak slow and intentional, just convey my thoughts as clearly as I can. And also now I'm kind of doing more anecdotal stuff, like what's been happening in my life and how I relate that to anarchism, voluntarism, capitalism. And I'm getting many different topics of inspiration to do these videos. And so I have so many topics now. It's like each week, I'm like, I feel like I can do more than one a week now. I got so many topics. So
I think my hardest challenge is staying on topic, and you do that well. Like, you'll do a 10-minute episode or a 10-minute or a 20-minute or a 15-minute video, and it's just bam, right on target. You know, if just think about it for a second. If I do it, it's going to be by the time the thing's ending, it's going to be about the Illuminati and aliens or something. So
so basically you're Alex Jones is what.
I got to find a way to stop myself from going Alex Jones on the whole thing. And that's why I haven't really been doing videos, is because I watch the videos I put out and I'm like, man, I just kind of ramble sometimes, or not ramble, but go down rabbit holes that can bury the lead very hard. And you stay on target, Danilo.
Yeah, I mean, thank you. It's like anything. You got to practice, and you know, in the beginning, I kind of sucked, and I feel like I've gotten into my groove a little bit, and speaking slower, and not tripping. I think that's a big thing that you, Jeremy, have been telling me about, is like, you know, got to speak slow, and you know, focus on limiting the, you know, the likes and the ums and all the those little excess words that we use, and so yeah. Just like that.
Exactly. Yeah, no, that's exactly true. And it's funny you mentioned that, because I've had to do that and focus on that ever since I've started being part of the podcast here on Seeds of Liberty. And when I was on Radiologic podcast with Merrick, it's the same thing. You have to catch yourself not using those filler words. And it's such a hard habit to break too.
Yeah.
It is.
It takes a minute to break them.
Well, they're crutch. Everybody has crutches, and it's easy to fall back in it. I think it was Jim Jesus who was talking about it once. I'm pretty sure it was him who said that he got over them by actually just not saying anything, like recognizing that he was about to do it and catching himself, because the reason that most people use them is to fill, because you're trying to think ahead and trying to think of what the next thing you're going to say is. So you'll put in an or a like, you know, and draw it out.
Yeah, you don't want to drop into silence. So you fill it with something.
Yeah, I think it was him who said he actually corrected himself by kind of letting the silence happen. And it could almost be uncomfortable for other people who were listening, but he didn't care. And it was just training himself to like, so you don't want to have the silence. So, okay, now I got to get rid of the silence. But it wasn't just going to that crutch, you know, to that crutch word right away. But it's tough. I mean, I still catch myself doing it. And I listen to the show multiple times because we do it and then I edit it. Yeah. And then we, and then I edit it, you know, and then I go through the editing process and I hear all of our likes and ums and I'm just like, and I smack myself in the head repeatedly, but it's tough. I think.
Well, I think I had the idea of that, you know, when you're on radio, they say dead air is the enemy of radio.
Oh, yeah. Sure. On radio, that's, you know, one thing.
Right. So I always think about that. But when I look back at my videos, my 10 short videos, there are a good amount of pauses and spaces of silence. Mm-hmm. And I don't edit those out either. I just leave those in, and I think I like the natural feel of it. Like if sometimes we look at a jump cut video, it just feels too artificial, unnatural. It's just like machine gun talking.
Well, yeah, it's a product. It's a product, right, is what it ends up being.
Well, you know, people are short attention spanned these days, and if you have all this stuff where people can't essentially just jam through the content real quick and get on to the next content, they're going to move along. And that's just on certain spectrums, so to say. So like on Facebook, it's a little different. On Twitter, it's a little different. But I think the general aspect of everything is putting out good content that is logical and coherent. And Danilo does that.
Yeah, I think I have like 33 videos so far of the short ones. And I can't believe that I've done so many already. I'm just doing once a week. I'm trying to be consistent with it. I can't wait till the summertime to get back outside to do it.
And you're getting a decent amount of reach with those, right? Are you seeing a good influx of numbers to your page by doing it or what?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I usually get like 2,000 views. And that's, of course, I have all these pages I share too. So that really helps a lot. I got a good amount of pages. People are sharing them too. And I'm now on the everythingvoluntary.com with Skylar Collins. He puts my content out on his newsletter. So that's really nice.
Oh, Skylar. Yeah, we know Skylar. We had him on way back when, somewhere in the 20s
episode
or 30s.
19 or 20.
Right.
Somewhere right, there, right. Yes.
So what, other than doing videos and being a badass, me and Jeremy know you just moved, but do you want to fill in everybody on like what's been going on in your life? Maybe catch everybody up that hasn't heard from you in a while.
Yeah. I mean, so I stopped doing Seeds of Liberty, I think in the last year in August, I think. Right. The end of the summer. And I'm continue to do my guests. And I've had some fascinating people on. Let's see. I had Mary Ruwert, PhD. I haven't posted that one yet.
Oh, I was gonna say I don't remember that one. I'd love
to hear
from Mary.
These are the people I haven't had on yet. I mean, I haven't edited a post yet. I've had the philosopher, the Asian woman, and then I've had
I don't know her.
The philosopher. She's got her small channel, YouTube channel. She was on actually Anarchast. Jeff Berwick interviewed her. That's right. I kind of was inspired to.
Okay. I know. Yeah, I know who you're talking about. The philosopher. Yeah.
Yeah. The Asian. Yeah, the Asian woman.
Wait. Did she spell it F-A-U-X? Philosopher.
P-H-O.
No, it's P-H-O.
Because I was like, is somebody the Vietnamese noodles?
I started using that term recently. I'm like, is somebody else really using that already? I'm like, gosh darn it! I thought I was being clever.
You're not.
There's nothing new under the sun, Jeremy.
Yeah,
I don't
see
it anywhere, Andrei. Listen.
Mary, that was great. Mary Ruwer, she's a wonderful person. She's been in this scene for a long time.
Yes, I've read a lot of her. Like, she writes a lot of articles and stuff, right?
And books too. And she's been on like Stefan Molyneux and different places all over the. And Louis Mises interviewed her, Emancipated Human. And she just, her message, I'm also very much inspired by her. You know, her big thing is libertarianism is the best expression of love of your neighbor. Yeah. You know, that if you truly love your neighbor, you wouldn't advocate for their, for violence against them or for theft. Or, you know, you would advocate for their freedom. And that completely makes sense. You know, that if we want freedom for ourselves, we must necessarily want it for our neighbors, right? And anyone else?
Well, I don't know.
People don't realize that this isn't king land anymore. Like, if you put a noose around someone's neck, you're essentially putting it on yours with democracy. So unless you're trying to become some feudal lord, I would not involve myself with the state, you know?
As far as her message, I mean, I do like her message, although I don't know if it necessarily has. I mean, I guess it could have to do with love, but I mean, I can't stand most of my neighbors. I still wouldn't wish any of that stuff. I still wouldn't wish any of that stuff upon them anyway. I'll still offer them the same.
Jeremy, the quintessential curmudgeon. If you're this angry and I don't know, hateful towards your neighbors at 40, I mean, I honestly can't imagine what 80s.
I've been
like.
Angry and hateful at my neighbors since I was a little kid.
Are you
kid,
just gonna fire a bazooka at any location at anybody that just makes a sound?
I have not shot anybody yet over this. I don't think it's gonna happen now.
Yet.
What he's gonna do is get a hold of a recreational McNuke from the local McWarlord.
Oh yeah.
Because by then we'll all be living in Ancapistan, so we'll be able to do that.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That will be wonderful.
40 years. All right. Well, you heard it here first on the Seeds of Liberty podcast. Ancapistan will be full-fledged and apparently enforced by, what would that be? Shit.
McDonald's with machine guns.
2060. Let's just round it out to 2060. So by 2060, you'll be able to purchase recreational McNukes.
From McDonald's.
Trademark, copyright.
You'll be able to just walk into McDonald's, McNukes. Get a Happy Meal. And a nuke.
Tactical. You know, I think this is a great topic because so many people, you know, have this idea that not everyone's going to be an angel if there's anarchism or, you know, if the state disappears. So how are you going to protect yourself against that? And you know, I think our response or my response would be that it doesn't hinge upon that. It's a moral statement that, you know, there are no exceptions to morality. It doesn't matter what badge or costume you wear. And so, it's all about accountability and personal responsibility for your actions, right? Mm-hmm. So if you do see an injustice, then you can take action. And most anarchist volunteers do. They take matters into their own hands.
Shove a recreational McNuke up somebody's ass.
Well, the other thing I'd like to add to that is, and I agree with you. It really is. It's a point of making a moral stand and being consistent about your ethics. Mm-hmm. But the other point I like to point out, and the other one that I really harp on a lot when this conversation comes up, because that objection does come up a ton, is what would you rather have? Would you rather have, you know, onesies and twosies? Yeah, somebody will most likely be robbed. Murders will still happen. People will still be unhinged and psychotic. But do you want to have it to where those incidents are isolated and few and rare, or do you want to have a system in place that essentially institutionalizes those behaviors? Do you want to have it widespread? Do you want to have a organization of people who have the ability to do these things with impunity, where it's expected that these things will happen?
Yeah.
I mean, which is really worse? Is it really worse to randomly get mugged maybe on the street? Or you to know for a fact kids, that you're going Andrei, to be robbed fine, consistently.
Mm-hmm. You just take, you know, the kids, so. Andrei. It's fine.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
It's fine. Just if you want to sleep tonight knowing that you hate the kids. That's okay.
Well, okay, it's the kids, the roads, old people, and the infirm, right?
My flag, and then my tradition.
Yes.
And it goes everything but, hey, I don't want a coercive monopoly dictating what everyone does. What does that have to do with fuck all about your tradition? Other than
you must hate children.
We've been traditionally enslaved. Let's keep it going. I don't get it. You know, like, why don't we?
Yeah,
just
that's the other argument that I cannot stand to hear. It's like, oh, well, we've always done things this way. Like, okay, well, for the longest time, people used horses to get around. Does that mean we don't use cars? Like, does that mean we shouldn't use cars because people have been taking horses the whole time? I mean, we haven't had computers for more than what, like 50 years. So what, should we do everything by hand?
You're just
like, that's the dumbest argument. It's
anti-worker,
so worthless.
Slavery was quite the rage for quite a while. Why did we stop? It was so efficient, right?
Oh yeah, totally.
You know, any of those things, anything.
But who will pick
the
cotton?
It's not. Yeah, but
who will pick?
That's one of the major first like things that slapped me upside the head like during this whole like when I learned about this stuff first was who will pick the cotton, because the first time you hear it, you're like, and then you really think about it and you're like, wait a second, I've actually thought out who will build the roads. It's no different than who will pick the cottons. They're both built by slaves essentially.
Actually, I mentioned that very argument just today when I was at this place. I go to my kids, they take some like science classes and some math classes like for homeschoolers. And I was talking to this woman that's also on my emailing list, and she was asking about anarchism and voluntarism. And I was explaining the basics to her, and I mentioned that very thing, like abolitionists in the 19th century opposed chattel slavery on moral grounds alone, and the slave masters would often say, well, if you take away the slaves, who's going to pick the cotton? And so they're not foreseeing the rise of the industrial machines. They don't know that's going to happen, but they're like, I don't care who's going to pick the cotton. It's just wrong to own human beings. And that's it.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So our arguments from antiquity always fall on their face because history is replete with examples of how innovation and progress have obviated the need for all of these systems of authority and rulership.
Whenever a society has a system of slavery, there's always been an accompanying system of the state, right?
Yeah.
Okay, like there's never been, I mean, I'm sure there's like tribal instances of like one tribe completely enslaving another one, but that's essentially the state as well. So like they're the same thing, slavery and statism. Like you cannot have the state without enforcing slavery, in my opinion. And you can't have slavery without the state there to enforce it. Like the first police in America were slave patrols. Like,
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, find me an instance other than like some small scale, like Ooga Booga taking over another Ooga Booga. I mean,
that's a technical economic
term. Racist. Well, how is it racist? I specified.
You can find that in nothing. You can find that in Mises.com.
Ooga Booga. Some Amazonian tribe takes over another Amazonian tribe. You know, that's
so. That's not what I'm so. That's about what you here. Think of Amazonians is their Ooga Boogas. That's what I'm getting. So when you think of Ooga Booga, you picture like Amazon tribes, like mud people, basically, is what you're getting at, Dave.
I don't know.
Evolving quickly.
Dave,
I'll stop. I'm sorry.
I'm talking about I can't, off the top of my head, think of a system of slavery that existed sans state.
Hmm. Yeah, well, it's an inefficient
Ooga Boogas or not.
Yeah, it's an inefficient institution that relies on state subsidies because you know it's like what's more efficient, to force people by violence to work or to compensate them and trade with them? What's more efficient?
To be fair, I don't think you could really qualify like small tribes as state back before we had larger organizations and groups of people, but I understand what you're saying. Like without the complicit approval of the entire group, slavery would just not happen.
Technically, one person exerting force on another person is then temporarily becoming the state because they are trying to monopolize force in a geographical location. So, I mean, technically.
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't trying. I didn't want to go down necessarily that rabbit hole, but yeah, you're not incorrect. I'm just.
I don't even know about that. I don't, because again, we have very different definitions of the state. I see the state.
Perhaps
the state is a belief system, as far as I'm concerned.
I think it's a geographical monopoly on coercion and.
I think we can all agree that it's not actually real. That it's just a.
Yeah, it's a.
It's a justification. It's a
mean going awry.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I like Mark Stevens' definition, which is state doesn't exist. It's just men and women with guns forcing you to pay them.
Yes.
And, or just a belief in authority, belief that some people have moral exemptions to morality that other people do not have. So in that sense, statism is a state of mind, and freedom as well is a state of mind. Right. So when people say, you know, are you ever going to see freedom? Well, you know, you live free. You exude freedom. You know, you demonstrate it by your very actions in your life, the way you raise your kids, the way you transact in your business. That's what freedom is, you know. And if people try to steal from you and rob you and assault you, then, you know, you have every right to defend yourself. So that's, you know, I think Albertus Camus.
Camus. That's Camus, right. I was thinking of the same.
Yeah, yeah. He's like, live. What's the only response?
The only way to deal with an unfree world is to become so absolutely free that your very existence is an act of rebellion. That's what it was.
I love that. Yeah.
It's a great quote. And I mean, it's 100% true. Like it starts with you. I mean, we can talk about how, you know, we need to build momentum for these things and we need to spread the message, but ultimately it really if you want to live free, that's entirely on your shoulders. You will be as free as you want to be.
Absolutely.
Or as you can afford to be, really. Well, as you determine you can afford to be.
Well, I think that's much more accurate, because I mean we've talked about that plenty on
this. Yeah, and that's why I went back and corrected myself.
No,
because it's not.
No, go ahead. Sorry.
Well, I was gonna say, because it's not necessarily like, because I mean all of us want to be free. Like, I don't think any of us want to live under the yoke of the state. But at the same time, the level of risk that you're willing to undertake is entirely a value judgment that sits in the individual. Right. Like, nobody else can make that judgment call for anybody else. It's how free you can afford to be in that moment.
Yeah, I think you got to find any cracks of freedom that you possibly can, but also you have to be mentally unenslaved as well. You have to dechain your mind from statism.
Yeah, which is always the first step.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. Mm-hmm. Most people, aside from, you know, I guess quote unquote criminals who are breaking specific laws, most people aren't in that mind, aren't anywhere near that mindset, and aren't considering just saying, no, I want to be free. They don't, you know, they'll put up with what's in front of them instead. So yeah, obviously the first step is recognizing all this stuff. Then once you get there, I mean, like I said with Andrei, I mean, that's, I agree with your clarification, because yeah, it's, we've talked about it before. It's, you know, risk benefit, you know, all the time. You gotta weigh it out. I mean, I will agree with you that it isn't anybody's place to decide for someone else how much risk they can and should take. But that doesn't stop me from being a judgmental prick about it sometimes and saying, listen, I really think that a lot of people take advantage of this and don't do anything about it and just bitch about the state and say, oh, the state's in my way for this, and the states or government or whatever term they use, it's in my way, I can't do anything about it. And then then that type of stuff irritates me on a personal level, and I recognize that it's personal, it's an emotional thing for me. I understand that. I don't have a logical argument against them. It's purely emotional when I say, listen, I'm out here risking a whole bunch of shit. You know, there's really I run into so many people who just talk a great game about this and what they would like to see, and they're great at theorizing, but when it comes to actually putting anything into play, they're not willing to take any chances. And it's kind of curious to me, because I don't understand, you know, because I don't really think I've come across too many people who don't willingly break certain laws or regulations because they think they're stupid. Not for any, you know, regular everyday people who still, you know, for whatever level are.
I drive through red lights sometimes.
It's a hard thing, right? Because like, we're not this huge giant collective, and we're not trying to build a huge giant collective for the means of getting something collectively done, right? We're all trying to get everyone to wake up and realize they're an individual and they should act like it. So it's really hard to get a big movement going and take action outside of, you know, philosophizing and spreading the message any way you can, like taking actual direct action to take down the state, because you're one person, you can easily be removed from society. I mean, the CIA could probably kill 10,000 people a day and no one would even know. So, I mean, it's really hard to sit here and say people should be taking action when the path is very unclear, and I think you have to choose your own path.
Well, absolutely, you know? But I think you're talking two different things there. I'm not talking about taking collective action. I'm talking about individuals. Just, there's so many different things that people could be doing. You don't even, not everybody has to be doing the same thing. But there, I was referring more to the people who I run into, like I said, who have ideas, have things they think, you know, when they talk about how they would live if they were free or if this stuff wasn't in the way, they don't. And then when pushed, it's like, well, why aren't you trying to accomplish some of this now? I continually run up against, well, I can't do it because of the government in this instance, or because it's illegal, or because they have a regulation. It's like, well, okay, yes, there are these things there, but there's a lot of these quote unquote chances that you can take that are not as big as a risk as most people would think. They just, it's being conditioned to fear, which is what this all comes down to. That's what the whole risk reward thing comes down to in this situation. The reason most people choose not to take the risks is because of this ingrained fear of what will happen to them if the state government, whatever, gets a hold of them because of any quote unquote wrongdoing they were, you know, a party to.
And they don't care how scared you are, or how much you hate them, or how much you think you want to do against the state. As long as you keep paying and shut up when they demand it, they don't care.
Yep.
Yeah. So, they really
right. Are. Right. Yeah. Right. That reminds me of a quote. I think it was Thomas Hague, some like secretary of something. It said in the '80s, is like, let them protest and march all they want as long as they pay their taxes.
I was on a Tom Woods episode recently, wasn't it?
Was it? I don't know.
I think so.
Oh, I was like, but, yeah. I thought that's where you got it from.
It's like, if you had this huge plantation, right? And you had a bunch of slaves there, and all they did was say, I hate this, but they still went to work every damn day. Right. Not yeah, fight, didn't slave master nothing, wouldn't give a obeyed shit. Completely, except for they just bitched about it constantly.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You're not going to change anything because they're essentially paying their taxes by doing the labor.
Even if they regularly held a protest, but still continued to work anyway, like if you know they got up and complained for a little while, but then it went right back to doing what they were doing, same effect, which is why I always say that, you know, extrapolate that out to like the bigger, you know, from a plantation to a nation. And, you know, you have the same thing where it's just the government loves acts of civil disobedience because it's not really getting anything done. People are getting up there voicing their opinion, but then they'll still accept being robbed. They'll still accept people being thrown in cages over, you know, arbitrary whims of politicians and lobbyists. And they'll still accept the, you know, bombing of brown people and, well, people of all colors all around the world. And, you know, they'll still accept all of it even after doing all that complaining. And even if they get one little thing changed that they think they have some victory, the state doesn't care. The government doesn't care because they just keep marching on because
it just
they love that. They yeah, want yeah. That.
Like, I have a point here. I made this simple observation during the primaries of this big, you know, presidential election in the United States we've had recently. Rand Paul got a group of volunteers to call 1 million people in like a week in Iowa, okay? Imagine if those 1 million people that were called were just told, hey, why don't you grab a search engine or Google real quick and just type in the word volunteerism and just read everything you can and just hung up. Seriously. Just cold call people, hey, why don't you Google volunteerism? Hang up. That would have had more of an effect for freedom than calling people, telling them to go vote for Rand Paul, who had no shot in winning anyways. You get what I'm saying? Just something like that.
Gives me an idea.
Well, maybe more people will get the idea and start doing it.
Yeah, that reminds me of, you know, when people, when they understand the idea that taxation is theft, And then they like, you know, they resign themselves and they say, well, what can I do? You know, just go to work. And I tell them during Nazi Germany, you know, you had the order followers who were doing all the violence. But really what empowered and funded them was the everyday German taxpayer that went to work and paid his taxes. Because really, without that, nothing could have been done. Nothing could have been funded without their willing consent to this system, right? They would have been crippled.
You saw what happened. He had to print money and collapsed his government.
Well, yeah. yeah, he was.
They couldn't pay the taxes he needed.
wonderful example of hyperinflation for the history books. But unfortunately, people still didn't learn their lesson, unfortunately.
That's fine. We just got to get the right color person to have socialism behind them and everything will be fine, right, Danilo?
Well, it's actually funny you guys mentioned this because, and I have recently kind of brought this topic up in a couple of conversations. In 1989, when the Romanian Revolution happened, they forcibly, like, they captured Ceausescu, who's the communist dictator, and his wife, who was just an awful human being and pretty much deserved to die as well. I mean, I'm not going to make bones about it. They were horrible human beings, and the world is a better place without them. But the interim government that was formed immediately in their wake was made of second-tier communist members. Mm-hmm. And they won free elections for, like, I think 4 election cycles before an oppositional party, which was still kind of just like socialist, but not quite hardline socialist like Ceausescu was with his cult of personality. He was basically a Stalinist. So rather than, I mean, they kicked him out and they got rid of the Stalinists, but they replaced him with not Stalinist socialists. So if history is any indication, people tend to not learn their lesson. They'll get rid of like the horror, the really, really horrible things. But I mean, compared to the really horrible things, the horrible stuff isn't quite so bad. So
there's only one political spectrum right now. You're either a liberal fascist or a conservative fascist. You're a fascist. You're just socialism doesn't exist, and neither does communism. Like, those are forces used to get people to vote for certain things and believe that certain things are going to happen after certain people get voted in. But fascism is the only thing that happens after people get elected. De facto, look it up, look up the definition of fascism, and then look at the results of what happens. I'm so sick of collectivist ideologies destroying our humanity. That's what it does. It destroys our humanity. It takes it away from us. I'm so sick of it.
Right. Yeah, you know, Andre, interesting mention about Ceausescu. That kind of hits home because my wife is Romanian. She grew up in communist Romania.
Yeah, you told me.
I did. Okay. And she experienced a little bit of that, and her mother experienced more. And I like to get their opinions of it. And it's interesting when you hear people who grew up in communism, what they thought of it. Some people, oftentimes, who had the government jobs, they liked it and they found it very cushy and nice. You know, her mother worked in the railroad, and you know, their reflections on it was like, you know, everybody shared, you know, you knew your neighbor, you would ask sugar and they would give you sugar, and everybody had the same amount of money, and
until everybody ran out of sugar and they had to wait in lines to get them.
Grand. And now we have all these choices, and it's horrible, and there's starvation, there's poverty, and there was no unemployment, and there's no poverty. But slowly, as I've gotten to know Monica, she's slowly understood that you know, the state is not just about giving you sugar and flour. Like, that's not the purpose of the state, is to give you sugar and flour. That's not what Ceausescu was there to do.
No. And it's really about, okay, you know, you knew your neighbors, and you could share amongst each other, and everybody made the same. But the question was, why? The why question is never asked or answered. It's just, oh, well, things were so much better. And that was... And when I spoke to my parents about it, because my parents grew up in it, they lived it, you know, they were born in the 60s. And so they lived through it, and they lived through the really dark economic period immediately before the revolution in the late 70s, early 80s. And the why was never asked until things got really bad. And then suddenly everybody started questioning the why. Like, why were things this way? Why are we in bread lines? Why are people threatening us for not wanting to deal with the states, you know, handing out and doling out food and supplies? So
yeah, and I also have in my homeschooling group, I have one woman who's she was from Kyrgyzstan, which was a Soviet Russia,
right?
And so her reflection about what that was like, and her family's reflection, is very interesting. Again, she looks at it fondly, her and her husband, in that, like, it was capitalism that came and destroyed everything. You know, everybody, it was safe and secure in the Soviet bloc, and Stalin was such a great guy. He kept everybody together. I know. And it's amazing the layers of
bullshit.
I don't know, of illusion, delusion, that I cannot penetrate with this woman, because it's so emotionally sensitive for me to even mention the fact that there were, like, gulags, and there were concentration camps, and there were, you know, people jailed for politically you know, unpopular opinions. And she's like, no, That's all lies that the capitalist countries made up about Stalin. Like, oh my God, I can't even touch that topic with her. So yeah,
the cognitive dissonance is just too strong.
Well, I mean, there again, if you have experienced something extraordinarily awful, the not quite so awful but still awful stuff, it's not bad. I can get behind that. That's what it boils down to.
And then another way I think about that is, a slave that's born into slavery does not know what freedom is, has no point of reference. Like, if you tell a slave that, you know, you can work and earn money, he's like, what's money? You know, there's just a complete ignorance about a different world. So how can you even talk about that with somebody who's never even known that, right?
Right, right, so exactly.
That's the other thing.
Well, and going back to what we were saying about slavery being a state institution, the only way I can see it not being that case is if it's generational slavery. If it's enforced by, like, a small community of people, which I guess you could create, but I mean, that's how that happens. If you're born and raised a slave, if that's all you ever know, and that's all that anybody ever tells you, that's how your mind is going to be. You will not know anything else. It'll be like Plato's cave. So the minute you're presented with freedom, you're like, I don't know what this is. This is horrible. Like, you mean I have to you mean I'm not going to have a place to sleep? I'm not going to be given food? I have to find these things? What's horrible. Name? Why would you want this?
On the Shawshank Redemption, the guy that hangs himself after he gets out for like...
Brooks.
Brooks syndrome.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like I posted a cartoon a while ago of and you see a bird in a cage, and then the bird the free bird comes to the window, and the bird in the cage is like, you know, I'm so happy, I got everything, I got shelter, I got food, I got water, my master takes care of me, and the bird outside is like, but you can't fly. Right, so the bird born in a cage does not know what flying means, which is very
exactly.
It's all a perspective thing. Yeah, it's a forced perspective.
Yeah. So that was Mary Rupert.
Mary Rupert. Going back to what we were talking about.
What you has been up to?
But let's see. I've had a guy, Tim Brochu from the Anarchitecture podcast. I heard about that through Tom Woods. That guy was fascinating. So looking at anarchism, he's focusing on it from the from the engineering architecture perspective, like you know, people say, you know, how would the roads be built? How would we have sewage? How would we have water? You know, if it's not the utilities are not monopolized, and he gives really great concrete explanations with that, and that's wonderful to hear that.
Sure, well, that's important because, like you said, that question gets asked a lot, so. Somebody's got to be working on that stuff, right?
yeah. I feel like my focus is more on the philosophy, the morality, and the economics aspect, and so I readily, defer to him because that's his specialty as being him and his brother are their engineer and an architect, so that's their strength, right? I was happy to talk to him. And I also talked to Rob Hussle recently. On his new music video, the Good Cops. That was fascinating. That's the first time I talked to him. I also discovered that he used to do stand-up comedy as well. So pretty cool.
Oh wow, okay.
So we have that in common as well.
I thought you had him on when he did his first song. You never had him on?
No, I tried to get him on a while ago, but it was really difficult to get a hold of him. And he didn't go to Anarchapulco this year. He went last year, I think. I think he's actually working on some kind of film. And so I might get him back on when he's finished with that to help him promote that. So
interesting. Cool stuff. Yeah, it was he made a name for himself. What was his first video? This is what happens when you call the cops, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, for anybody.
Yeah, I think millions and millions of views. I think.
Well, yeah, because that's a message that particular message can go out to more than just anarchists.
Right.
That, you know,
broader audience.
Yeah, exactly. You know, that's why, like, you know, all the different songs from the late 80s, early 90s, you know, when was NWA's? I don't even remember. Fuck the Police. When was that? 88? I don't know. Jeez, God, it's been so long. But all, you know.
You were in your, you were in your high, graduating high school then?
Yeah, exactly. I'm not that old, you fucking bastard. but yeah, anyway, I don't remember the exact things. But yeah, those will reach a much broader audience, you know. Tons of people from all different demographics got in on that because there's plenty of people who have had bad even people who would still be considered statists in like most other aspects of their lives. Plenty of those people have had negative interactions with the police and can understand that sentiment, you know, and with the rise of the internet and the fact that, you know, these videos are plastered everywhere all the time. I can't imagine there's too many people that are spend any significant amount of time on the internet over the course of a week haven't seen at least one of those by now, you know.
Right. Yeah,
there can't be too many people that have managed to avoid them for that long. So
what is it, what do they call them, like police brutality porn or something like that?
Yeah, something. Well, yeah. It's, I mean, I don't watch them anymore.
There's so much.
I think they were literally trying to cause a civil war between BLM and the the police, and that all this armament of them has just been a big ramp up for that. And I think Trump getting elected stopped it. Honestly, I do. I'm being dead serious. Like, if you hand on whatever you want me to swear on, seriously.
Well, you don't need to swear on anything for your opinion. I just don't think.
Think about it. There was a huge ramp up there for a minute. Wait, notice there's not been any BLM riots.
Which BLM are you talking about?
Black Lives Matter.
Okay.
A complete Soros front group. Proven.
Okay.
Yeah, I was about to say their funding sources, it's not even in question anymore.
And the same people that Soros work for, the Fed and the CIA and the U.S. government work for, so.
Well,
I mean, it was orchestrated.
Well, yeah, I understand. I understand that that's definitely more than possible at on every conceivable level at this point. I don't think there's ever an actual push to try to force a civil war. I don't think that would because that doesn't really benefit any of them. That cost
balkanization always benefits.
It'll benefit certain people, but not all the people, and not enough that they'd be willing to push it. And that's also a really hard sell to try to force that.
Well,
even amongst the people that are supposed to be making those moves and doing stuff like that, it's really hard.
It was just a thought.
So on the topic of Trump, how many of you voted for him?
I don't vote.
That was a rhetorical question.
I did vote. I walked in there. I wrote in Danilo Cuellar and walked right out.
I know you've been gone. Oh,
if I had to pick a president, it would have been Danilo.
in my homeschooling circles, I'm surrounded by Democrats, socialists, Bernie Sanders supporters.
Oh, sweet Jesus!
Golly, yeah, perfect.
And they were all like. Like, you know how, what was that, there was like a mental illness after the election, after he was elected, that people, they make up a new mental illness, like for people post-election Trump trauma syndrome or something like that?
Yeah.
Uncontrollable crying. It's serious. Like, people in my group, they had that. Uncontrollably crying. I couldn't believe it. My God. I'm like,
yeah, because they felt like the world was ending because their guy wasn't winning. It's the same thing when your team doesn't win in football or whatever.
Well, no, this is a little different. The people that took it to that extreme,
the level of delusion is different.
Because I've met, you know, I have met some of these people too, and they do exist. Yeah. I knew a couple. Like, I think I've spoken about it on the show before. Right after the election, I was all of a sudden in contact with a male liberal friend of mine who I haven't spoken to in years, who was pretty much on the verge of tears over the Bernie thing. Ooh. So, you know, like I've met people that take it to this extreme, but it's not just the loss. It's because at least the people that I've come across and the other ones out there that you see the videos of is that they all seem this way. It's that it's not just that that their person lost. It's the fact that they believe all the insane propaganda about Trump, and they actually think, like, there was people that I saw, like, there was different places that ran pieces, you know, over the past couple of months since the election, checking in with people who had, like, really believed that the death camps were coming and that people were going to be getting booted out of the country.
And Trump was a Russian agent.
Yeah, like, just like every crazy rumor, they all, like, these type of people that got that invested that they're crying on the drop of a hat over this stuff, they really believe these things. They really believe that he was anti-
It reminds me of that meme I made. Remember that chick that was yelling after Trump won at the inauguration, going, ah! I made that meme that says, when an orange-haired billionaire takes over your God. It was just, I thought that was the most apropos description of the poignant election. That was what happened. An orange-haired billionaire took over the liberals' God.
it was poignant, and you're absolutely right. And I think that's what it came down to, is they treat the state like essentially a deity. It'll provide. The state will provide.
Dude, they have to say prayers to Hugo Chavez in Venezuela still. And I'm all for
my God.
Okay. Wow. They have to say prayers. They go to, like, Hugo Chavez churches. They have to, like, if you don't think Obama wants the same thing or ever any of these other tyrants, you're crazy. This is what these people feed on. This is everyone that has, you know, like that thing in the back of your head, person that's listening, that says, man, we really should have the state for this. They think I should have the state for me, and they don't really care about you.
I mean, to varying degrees. I don't think every leader of a state organization necessarily has a cult of personality, but it's definitely there. The framework is there. They're all sociopaths. I mean, that goes without saying.
Well, suppose, yeah, I would say probably at least, if not all of them,
most of them,
the amount that is not would be so insignificant you wouldn't report it. How about that?
Yeah, there you go. It's not statistically significant. There we go.
Yeah, that's a very good phrase.
The level of sociopathy in politics is not statistically significant. Or
the level of non-sociopathy.
Non-sociopathy.
Right.
That's it. Damn it.
A slight detail there.
Yeah.
Statist.
I think that would wreck our entire argument, Dave.
That damn work. The whole show.
That's flipped. That's it. That's right it. There. Dave's outed himself as a statist. Everybody, let's shun him. Let's point and laugh and shun.
Shun the non-believer. Shun the non-believer.
And you know what? So in my group, they intensely despise Trump so much that if I start criticizing Trump, I think that's going to lead them to believe that I wanted the other guy to, or Hillary to win.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't at all. I just say, I don't care who sits on the throne. I'm against it. It doesn't matter.
I don't want the throne. Well, dismantle the throne. Right, I don't care who was it.
I understand that. But if at least post-election now, I have found that pointing out, or at least being willing to discuss the bad things that he's doing right now, is actually very beneficial when talking to such people. Like, that's how I was actually able to make inroads with these liberal, you know, these liberal friends of mine that I hadn't spoken to in years, because they had all kind of written me off. Once I, you know, it was bad enough when I flirted with the Tea Party and then went to the Libertarians, you know, that was bad enough for them. Then when I went full-blown anarchist, they all lost their shit and they were just like, you know, this guy's crazy. We're out of here. But the ones that I started talking to again, it was interesting because I was still like, they had kind of, I guess they kind of expected me to just let off the gas or something and not go after Trump. But because I continued to hammer the things that he was doing and pointing them out, like from the get go, they were just like, wow, that's interesting. It appears that you haven't changed your message at all. You're just like, exactly. Because
I have a meme for you, Jeremy.
I don't care exactly which one it is. I don't care which side is in, because it doesn't matter to me, which, to your point, Danilo, I do agree with that. But I'm able to use that now with such people, which is why I laughed every time somebody's, you know, I see somebody ranting about how you can't reach the quote unquote collective of the left. I'm like, sure, you can't reach any collective. You can reach individuals, though. And that's what I do.
and it's amazing how people can overlook the atrocities of a regime, because, like, let's say, for example, Trump, like especially in the homeschoolers, they're like, Trump, he's against vaccines. Oh, that's good. And in my mind, I'm thinking, well, but he's still drone bombing brown people. Oh, okay. Trump is good for business. Wait, but he's still drone bombing brown people. Trump is Trump is dismantling this federal agent. Wait, but he's still drone bombing brown people. Wait, don't you care about that?
Yeah, I mean, he could, day one, turn off all military operations. Like, that's not a... He's the commander in chief. Like, you're definitely right on this, Danilo.
Like, how can you overlook that? I don't understand. Like, oh, it's good for business.
War is the health of the state, man. They got to keep those engines pumping. Well, imagine if Trump goes against the military industrial complex. Bye bye. See ya.
But that's
every speech he does. He goes, guys, I'm going to rebuild the army. I'm going to increase funding. I mean, what does that mean? That means more money's going to military contractors. Fact.
Well, of course. But the answer to your kind of almost rhetorical question, Danilo, is like, why do they go there with that? Well, because that's all they, you know, going back to what we were talking about earlier about kind of like, you know, not knowing any different because that's the environment you grow up in. Well, there's tons of people, especially the millennials. They've known nothing but like hard, like not just war in the sense that, you know, what is that meme that always gets floated around, the fact that the U.S. has been at war for like 227 of the 238 or whatever it is years, something along those lines, whatever it's up to now. I guess the numbers have changed a little bit. But, you know, the fact that anybody pretty much post the first Iraq war, you know, Gulf War, was that 91, 92, 93, somewhere in there? I can't remember exactly. Mm-hmm. Pretty much since then, because then you had, you know, with Clinton, you had Kosovo and what was the other one?
Somalia.
Yes. Yeah. You know, it hasn't stopped. like
no all Somalia the past couple of being bombed and shot up by American soldiers.
That's true too, but I was just talking about in general, like those two, and then it just happened, and then 9/11, like it's just been nonstop. Like that's all these past couple of generations know, so they just, a lot of people can just kind of write that off with as, well, that's kind of like one of those things that's always there, like we were talking about much earlier, like, oh, it's just kind of accepted.
We've always been at war with Eurasia.
Yeah, it's a short-term short-term appeal to
we've
antiquity.
Always been at war with
not really
the
antiquity, but yeah.
Yes. I've been wanting to make that meme for a while.
Well, I said that when they started talking about when there was talks about Russia and the United States kind of teaming up to prevent China from becoming a bigger power and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, yeah, of course, we've always been, and I said it right away, we've always been at war with East Asia because that's just the way
people
right.
are going to, that's yeah. right.
I got a meme idea for you, Jeremy. It's the shattered out picture of Trump, and it's a Pokemon frame, and it says, who's that president? And then below it's got your picture, and it just says, I don't care.
That's right. That's great. Oh, speaking of memes with your picture in it, Jeremy, that shit for the Church of the Immaculate Succession, you and Dave, that is solid gold.
Yes,
that was fantastic.
Did you make it the profile pic of the?
I made it. It is the profile pic of the Church of the Immaculate Succession.
Oh, I didn't see that one man, yet. That is fantastic.
You haven't seen.
You
that?
Have got to see it.
Our friend Travis McQuivy, who's going by the name of MacFeen right now on Facebook, but he's a huge Fiend fan, and he's been like the resident Fiend memeologist for a long time and helping out with stuff like that. And, nice. Him and I have gone back and forth with memes for quite a while now, but I always bowed out to him cause he's got better Photoshop skills than me. But yeah, he made that for us and shared it. And I thought it was quite funny. Yes. It's Dave and I proselytizing for the church
today.
And, yeah, it's good stuff.
It's like Mav Fiend tagged me. I'm like, who is this? And I see it. I'm like, holy shit, this is epic.
I love the faces he chose because I look so I
yeah,
look,
that's
I
what
look
I'm
so
saying.
Excited.
They're perfect.
I look so excited, you know, for anybody
we can see the whites around your irises. You look like
so it
you
has
look
to be
insane.
This picture for the podcast.
And then Dave's just like laughing in the like laughing on off to your side, just full throat laugh. Just it's great. God, is it good?
Well, that's the Dave bellowing pick that I've used for many a meme.
Yeah.
right.
But it is a good one, but yeah, it's pretty funny. But yeah, for anybody who hasn't seen it, it's Dave's head and my head on two little, you know, two basically, you know, like Jehovah's Mormons. Witnesses or Mormons. That's what it is. Mormons showing up at somebody's door to preach the word. And
have you Googled voluntarism?
Yes.
it's quite, here's a copy of the Anatomy of the State. See ya.
Yeah, somebody asked if we hand out flyers. I said no. Dave just carries a bag full of copies of Anatomy of the State. And he throws them at him as we get run off their porch. He's like, here, just read this.
Thanks.
Well, on the bright side, using Anatomy of the State, you can use that as a defensive weapon since it's large enough and heavy enough.
Oh, it's actually really, really, really small. Anatomy of the State.
Yeah, but it's bigger than a pamphlet. So, you know,
you could roll it up and use
there's
it as a club.
If
you have
a pamphlet
to.
Version of Anatomy of the State, we need to get Andrei to rewrite it at strictly a sixth grade reading level.
Oh,
and then
Jesus Christ.
I can go put it in everybody's mailbox.
I'll put
that. You know what? I would be willing to do that. I would be willing to donate my time and effort to make that happen. Yes. I will make that a reality.
That would be great.
I'll send you the pamphlet.
That's something we could. That's something I could put. I keep saying I want to put one of those free little libraries out in front of my house.
Because I mean, he says
I'll put some of those in there. It'd be great. Here, take this.
Rothbard is very Matt. He just gets very verbose sometimes. That I think it goes a lot over a lot of people's heads.
Yeah, he does. So Jeremy, whatever happened to our we were going to go in the city and do some man in the street
talk
in Manhattan.
We can never manage to work out times to do anything else.
Jeremy,
I mean,
gets arrested every time.
I try to get Danilo to come up here next week, and just like he's like, what can you do with this? Like, no, I'm working. And it's just because in Danilo's world, he doesn't understand, like, you know, work during the course of the day because he's with
exactly.
his kids all day. So it's
I'm the homeschooling father.
Exactly.
What's work?
He gets arrested every time he goes to New York City. He can't come.
Yeah, I really don't want to go. I mean, I did say I was going to. The last time I was going to go close to New York City was before good old Shia LaBeouf moved his.
The cops
his,
had him alert.
Shia LaBeouf. Alert.
Before he moved his, because he had his live stream thing that just got busted, you know, got tracked down by the 4chan guys, which was hysterical, by the way. Use it. What did they say? They used.
Amazing. Yeah, God, what was it? That made my week.
They used.
What, that, no, I take that back. That made my month.
That was spectacular.
He put it out on a farm. He put the flag out on a farm. If people don't know, he put this camera up on a He Will Not Divide Us flag on a farm in Tennessee, and 4chan found it out through watching the live stream through flight patterns and astrological stars. They geolocated the place. Someone jumped the like fence, went in there, swapped it out with a MAGA hat, a Make America Great hat, and left.
Yeah, it was beautiful. It was masterful. And the fact that they were able to do that is just genius. But that's what I was saying is before he moved it there, I think it was in New Mexico before that. And before that, it had been in New York. It started in Queens at one of the, I think it was in Queens, yeah.
He isn't a good enough troll. If I'm Shia LaBeouf, I'm putting it up on a green screen, and that green screen's going to change locations every 48 hours just to screw everyone up. What it's showing, you know, like it'd be over here one week. People don't think. They're not good.
You know what, though? To be fair, even if Shia LaBeouf did that, I have enough confidence now in 4chan to think that they would still be able to figure out where it is.
Well, yeah, even if it's like a basement somewhere. They would go there and it would be empty-handed, right?
No. They would find him.
Yeah, they would find him.
They would hack into the IP that's this. Yeah,
they'd find a way just to mess with him.
I wouldn't put it past them to be.
Well, it was somebody put out a meme from it was a screenshot from Reddit, and they were talking about how like Shia LaBeouf is going to contract with SpaceX to like fly it out to the moon, to the dark side of the moon, and then 4chan's going to figure out it's on the dark side of the moon. And then 3 months later, they'll generate enough funds to create and build their own rocket ship to send somebody up to the moon to troll it, and then they'll just island hop across the solar system as Shia LaBeouf keeps moving it farther and farther out. And eventually, like, 4chan and Shia LaBeouf are going to be the reason that we eventually leave the solar system.
Trolling.
Yes.
That's probably this pretty much going to be the future of humanity right now. Who can troll the other the best and make them look the shittiest?
That's right. Competition is good. Competition is great. Competition builds.
It's moving from rifles to memes, which I'm fine with.
Well, if
that's yeah, me too.
If right. that if that type of insane competition gets us out of the solar system, then I'm all for it. I am. Exactly. I want to see that happen.
Meme us to another planet.
Carl Sagan never saw it coming.
Oh, I can do Carl Sagan too.
Oh gosh.
I'm Carl Sagan.
No.
Shia LaBeouf started what he didn't know. Was humanity's general. I got nothing.
Yeah, I was going to say that doesn't.
Expanse into the solar system.
That's not doing it.
I can't do it, and I haven't done Carl Sagan.
I was
going
to say,
I forget who I can do.
Stick to your AJ, man. Just.
I can't forget who I can do, man. And I can really do Carl Sagan. Like, I'll do it next episode. Just okay. Give me a few minutes to practice.
I remember clearly your Jesse Ventura.
Well, the last time he did it, it morphed into Alex Jones, and then he tried to do them both together, and it just turned into the same thing.
Well, that's what I said. I said he should never, because he tries to do that, and once he tries to talk back and forth as both of them, they start blending together.
They're too raspy.
Well, yeah, they're very similar.
When you hear them separated by time, like when you don't hear them like back to back, it's like, wow. But yeah, if I had a script and I had like an Alex script, I could read it. And then I could read a Jesse script in response to all those, and then you could just put them together, and it'd be hilarious. Them together,
yeah, that would be good. We'll get to work, Dave.
Oh man, I wish.
Well, you're supposed to be, you know, on that with Tinfoil Wars. That would be perfect for that.
Yeah, I'm thinking about just contacting Alex Jones and seeing if he wants to buy it, so nothing bad happens with Tinfoil Wars. You know what I'm saying?
Nonsense. We just got to get started. And we got to get the ball rolling. That's all.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. So.
Nice.
Stephen Molyneux is going to be next.
Yeah.
Actually, I think.
Why not Stephen Molly? Yes.
The guy Seamus Coughlin who does the Freedom tunes.
Yeah, he's great.
He did that. You remember that video where he was making fun of Molyneux?
Yeah. Yeah.
And with the paper bags,
yes.
And then he posted that, I think, somewhere under his Twitter or something like that. And then Molyneux banned him.
Yep. Yeah, Seamus.
Or blocked him or something like that.
I don't think so. I'm pretty sure you liked it.
Oh, no. No, no.
No, he did?
He's been blocked because of it. I'm almost positive.
Who knows?
Seamus is a funny guy. He's on the Freedom Fiends now, too, so I've got to talk to him for a couple of shows.
Awesome, yeah. He's been pretty prolific on his channel. He's putting out some good stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He had Eric July for that one. That was awesome. He's like, black people don't forget to do the laundry. We just leave it on the floor or something.
Yeah, it was like, just the ludicrousy of like political correctness right now is insanity. It's dying so quickly that like even like old people are laughing at this stuff now. They're like, I heard an old lady say, "What are you, an SJW?" to somebody else the other day. So like I know like
wow,
like it's the cultural tides are turning. That's why I've always, since this picture became real clear for me, changed my message to you really need to be attacking the culture, the state, the government, the president. None of that matters. You have to attack the culture.
Yeah, that's the only way change happens, because you know, as we know, politics is a lagging indicator of society, and society is a lagging indicator of culture. It all starts with culture.
Mm-hmm.
The only way you can have lasting progress in any direction is by changing culture.
Yep.
Yep. Well, I think that's a perfect
way. I think we've all ran out of steam here at the
show. No, I was just about to say that was a perfect way to wrap up the show, and then you just ruined it, Dave. Thanks.
Well, you can edit that. Say it was a perfect way to wrap up and just edit
it. I already did, Dave. It's fine. Oh. We'll leave it in to remind you of, you know, when you listen back to this, you'll cringe, and then hopefully you won't do it again. it's kind of like...
I'm past cringing at myself.
Cringing is good.
Damn it, Dave. You're going to have to rub your nose in it like a dog. All right. Anyway, I'm just kidding. I do not agree with that practice. anyway, well...
Right. Would that be considered puppy abuse?
I'm calling it better business bureau.
I know people that like to do that. I'm not a big fan of it.
My dog got inconveniently hurt by Jay's...
Get out of here. All right. That's enough.
I'm kidding.
All right. On that note... I guess we should get going. So Danilo, this has been, it's been a lot of fun having you back on, man. It was good to actually talk to you. We barely speak anymore, man. What happened? You know
what? Well, we keep in touch as much as we can. Life is, it's changing. It's different, but I'm trying to keep up doing what I'm doing. And I know you guys are doing what you're doing, and that's wonderful. And I'm grateful to hear that it's still alive and kicking, and I hope it continues. So here's to many more episodes.
Yes.
Yes, many, many more episodes. I thoroughly enjoy being on here. So I very much hope that this does not go away.
Well
in 2 years when we have episode 200, we'll have everyone back on and we'll see what happens.
Well, we weren't going to get rid of you just yet, Andrei. That was the other thing. I did tease that on the Facebook page today, and we did actually ask you. So I guess we could finally say this now. Andrei has graciously accepted to join us on a more permanent basis from now on. So we've, I guess, technically finally filled the Danilo seat.
But it was inevitable.
Yeah, it was. We held out for a while, but I think
you didn't change the wall. What was it called? The cover photo on the Seeds of Liberty with all three of our heads yet?
You should check.
Oh, I didn't check it recently.
You should go check.
I didn't check it recently. Okay. I'll check it. You got the new one.
There's a new one up. So
awesome.
It's a terrible picture. Terrible picture. Jeremy refuses to change
it's a wonderful picture.
I'm officially history.
You're not history.
No, you're not. Get out of here.
It's not like I'm scrubbing the old content and removing all the episodes that you're on.
No, hey. I really appreciate Andrei coming on and taking that spot. I kind of, you know, had my eye on getting Andrei on the show when Danilo decided to pull away, because he had the move coming up. He had all that other stuff coming up and wanted to pull away because he couldn't put his heart into it. And I saw Andrei, he puts out great content. I was like, man, this is the perfect guy to fill that Danilo spot. And I'm glad everything has kind of lined up for you for this to happen, Andrei.
Yeah. And I mean, I say it every time you guys have me on, and I know it sounds trite at some point, but it really is an absolute pleasure and an honor for me personally to be on the show on a recurring basis, to be here talking with you guys and to discuss the things that we're passionate about and we care about and the things that matter to us, to hopefully spread the message of liberty to everybody else that we can get a hold of. So it's, again, it's an honor to be on here, and I can't express to you how happy I am to be a permanent part of this, to be an ongoing host.
Yeah. Wow. Awesome. And I just want to add, I'll never forget when me, Jeremy, and Dave were talking on a, was it Voxer or was it Telegram? I don't remember.
I think it was Voxer.
But, yeah, it started on Voxer.
Dave said, he says, I like this, I'm like Johnny Appleseed. I like to spread seeds of liberty. Oh, that's it. That's it.
Yeah.
And it's such a good name. It's so good. Like you couldn't make this up again if you tried.
Right.
Divine Davespiration, I guess, happened. Davespiration. It just, it was one of those things where it was like, hey, anybody get a cool name? And I just kept throwing them out. And eventually it got to that. And it was like, hey, you know what? That's not bad. Cause I had a pitch behind it. But yeah, I'm glad it's lasted 100 episodes. I mean, shit, if the show ended tomorrow, it would be a success in my eyes. But I want to keep this thing continually going, because I know people, our numbers are going up. I know people are listening, and yeah, that's all I need.
Dave kept telling me that. I didn't believe him. I finally went and looked. I'm like, oh my God, they really have been going up. Yeah. We've been doing quite well.
We're making it, man.
Yeah.
We're doing it.
Especially over the past like 2 or 3 months, we've definitely seen a huge surge. And it's, I mean, before that we had some really, you know, great episodes that got huge numbers when we had certain guests on, but you know, our just overall numbers have been going up, and it's been great. So I guess that means, well, I mean, either people are really liking it, or it's the Howard Stern effect at work, where our haters are listening to us just to make fun of us or complain about us.
And in either case, I'll take either one.
I don't care.
The CIA is in there taking notes on everyone.
The increase in listeners is all CIA SOC accounts.
They all count as downloads. I don't give a crap.
Exactly.
Actually, on my Facebook page, I got this one woman who constantly comments. And this one guy commented under one of my videos saying, this is another guy that thinks if you just ignore the state, it's going to disappear. And then she comments under him saying, I know, I just follow him because I just want to see what crazy thing he says next. That's the only reason I follow him.
Well, that's exactly what the Howard Stern is. That's the line from the movie.
But I don't
can't
think
wait to see what he says next.
You don't say anything that crazy, dude. That's what's funny.
It's not crazy. It's to them, it's radical. And that's what these ideas are.
I'm so far down that when I look up at even just like what normal people have never even crossed their mind, some of these things, especially like deep state stuff. And I just am like, I'm already running on all this implied stuff, and I'm trying to have a conversation with you, and you don't even know the what color paint is on the surface of the thing you're supposed to be scratching.
Yeah, exactly. It's incredible, because every time you run into that conversation, especially with somebody who has no clue whatsoever, doesn't understand any of these references, you have to just like take a step back and be like, okay, so we need to start with the alphabet, and you need to understand what these letters are, and then
grammar,
we can start stringing
logic,
them together. Rhetoric. Exactly. It's
me and a friend were talking today, and we were talking about why so many people don't understand when a new philosophy comes across to their, you know, their ears or their brain or whatever. It's because most people that espouse a philosophy skipped the logic. They only know the grammar and the rhetoric. All they can do is rhetoricize the philosophy. They don't truly understand the principles or anything behind it that supports it. And so they can't clearly and honestly and emotionally defend it. All they can do is spout the rhetoric.
Yeah. No,
and
that's 100%
true. You have to get to a point with everything where you understand the logic behind what you're talking about. Otherwise, you say, this is what I've been told. I don't know.
Well, yeah,
but so many people just, the first thing they're told on something, it's like, well, this is right, and they go with it.
Yeah. Yeah. To me, it all comes down to basic definitions. You know, when I start talking to somebody about this stuff, I say, what's your definition of capitalism, of theft, of the state, of law, of regulation, of capital, you know, free markets, you know, and just from there, you can see where their mind is at and the way they see the world and go from there. And I find that that's a really easy way to bring them
and
to
that's
these
the first
ideas.
Thing you should be doing anyways, Danilo, is getting definition, getting them to define.
Right.
So you can speak on their language and their level. Even if they're a socialist, talk in their terms, guys. It may pain you. And I mean, if you read my Facebook, you know how much I hate commies. Like, I still talk in their language when I want to, when I really want to get into them. I still just speak like I'm one of them, but to my ends. And It's, call it whatever you want, but like, if somebody only knows a certain language, I'm going to speak that language if I can.
Sure. Well, try to anyway.
Yeah, try to.
Yes.
All right. Well, all right. Now I think we've gone on a exactly. long enough tangent.
It's too late, though.
We were trying to wrap up, but
I have to get Danilo on for 10 more minutes. Damn it!
That's all right.
Says the guy who doesn't have to edit the show. So
let's call.
Before we go on any more tangents, again, Danilo, it was great talking to you, man. For anybody who doesn't know already, go check out his information at peacefulanarchism.com. Is that your mm-hmm. website?
Yep.
That's where you can, find all his stuff.
Brazzers.
Andrei, it's
That's the alternate website. It gets redirected to peacefulanarchism.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, man. Can I get some ad revenue today? Jeez.
Yeah. Andrei, it's good to officially have you on board, buddy. So thank
you. Like I said, it's an honor. Thank you. It's an honor and a privilege. Thank you, guys.
And Dave, well, good to have you here as always, Dave.
I'm still here, unfortunately.
So once again, all this stuff will be in the show notes, but once again, please go check out the information for the Freedom BnB at hobosymbols.com. There is an Indiegogo campaign trying to get up some money to get this project off the ground and running. I mean, it's already up and running, but we're trying to get it along even faster. So, you know, go check that out and hopefully we can make this a reality soon, and we'll hopefully have Ben Stone on next week to talk about this in further detail, which should be really exciting. And all of our information can be found at theseedsofliberty.com on that crappy little website that Dave still hasn't done anything with. So thank you, everybody, for joining us, and we'll catch you next time. Peace.
Take care. Bye.
Peace.
Cell 411 is a free app for Android and iOS that replaces government-controlled 911. Cell 411 allows you to preset a group of friends or private organizations to show up in any emergency. Cell 411 is a nightmare for the state because it proves their so-called services aren't needed. Cell 411 has had thousands of installs, and of course it's covered by the BIPCOT No Government License. Cell 411 because your friends won't shoot you when you're in trouble. Without the government, who would build the emergency services? You and Cell 411. Get it today at getcell411.com. That's getcell411.com.
Of government lackeys who say you didn't build that? Are you tired of elitists who think you need a government permission slip for everything? Everything you do is an A to B conversation, and the government should see their way out of it. Create true free markets by adopting the BIPCOT No Government License. The BIPCOT No Gov License allows use or modification of any product, service, or software except by governments or government agents. Go to BIPCOT.org. That's Bravo, India, Papa, Charlie, Oscar, Tango.org.